ओम शांति शांति शांति। ओम वसुदेव सुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानंदं कृष्णं वंदे जगद्गुरुं। असतो मा सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मामृतंगमय। ओम शांति शांति शांति। Let us offer our salutations to Lord Krishna, the embodiment of divine bliss, who came to punish the wicked and establish religion, who gave the universal message for uplifting oneself in life. Let us pray to the Divine Supreme to lead us from the unreal to the real, to lead us from the darkness of ignorance to the light of knowledge, to lead us from death to immortality. We are studying Karma Yoga, the most important study we are making. Since every one of us is engaged in some kind of activity, so how this activity which we are doing can bind us, bringing misery and suffering, but the activity can also release us from suffering. And it paves the way for reaching the Divine Supreme. So both ways it acts. If we do activities mechanically, then we don't have much benefit in the spiritual sense. That means people become more restless, tension oriented, full of stress and strain, losing balance of mind. All these are effects of one's engaging activity in a mechanical way. But there's another approach. That approach is, whenever we do activity, dedicating the activity at the divine lotus feet of the Supreme, offering all the activities as dedication, that paves the way for peace of the mind. First of all, we should know the basic necessity for attaining everlasting peace is to have firm faith in the presence of the Divine. That's a very important step. People nowadays we find engaging in all sorts of worldly activities, not at all interested in anything that is called spiritual or divine. So then it won't work. You have to accept the reality. The reality is the divine is present everywhere, is all pervading. The whole universe is filled with divine consciousness. That awareness we should have. That is the result of knowledge. Light the lamp of knowledge, the darkness of ignorance vanishes by itself. So we are all in some kind of ignorance, so we are in trouble. After many births, one really becomes the aspirant for knowledge. After one practices it, he becomes deeply interested in practicing Jnana Yoga. That means the Karma Yoga should be done with Jnana. You must know what you are doing, and you must know the goal, and all necessary preparations are to be followed. That is, one should establish oneself in established character, that is, being truthful, honest, compassionate, loving, friendly, all the virtues are to be cultivated along with other things what we are doing. Everything should go side by side, not one after the other. That means our attention should be focused on the character as well as activity, both. And always we must be focusing on the Divine Presence. So, then it is possible to attain liberation, or we will be realizing the meaning of liberation in this very human life. We will realize that everything is the innermost self, Vasudeva. Bhuvanam janmanamante jnanavan mam prapadyate. Bhuvanam janmanamante jnanavan mam prapadyate. Vasudeva sarvaviti samahatma sudurlabha. So everything is the divine. Vasudeva sarvaviti. So a person who is having just theoretical knowledge, though he knows Vedanta, is unable to transcend the three gunas, sattva, rajas and tamas, which are causing all the activities and everything in this world. So, a person is unable to transcend these three gunas. That is, getting rid of hatred and aversion, and cultivating equanimity. Because of his hectic activity and extrovert tendencies, the person has no control over his senses. He is dragged by the senses. Senses rule the person. So, he is tightly under the control of the gunas. He acts under the dictates of his gunas. So, svabhavastu pravartate, all living beings act according to their nature. Even a person of knowledge is no exception to this rule. He, not knowing this, associates himself with his actions born out of gunas. He feels angry with himself and curses himself when his senses pull him out and suppresses impulses. The impulses will not die when suppressed, but will rise up with redoubled vigor sooner or later. What he should do is to dissociate himself from his gunas. View his own gunas expressing through his body, mind and intellect as a witness and try to sublimate the impulses by dwelling more and more on the true divine nature, the pure consciousness. So he has to do everything will be alright in course of time. Even trying to forget some unpleasantness, tragedy or sorrow in life is a kind of suppression. You must outlive the unpleasantness so that even when you remember them, they don't affect you. That means you must use your intellectual faculty and analyze yourself and connect yourself to the divine. Lord Krishna says in the Karma Yoga, verse number 34, Indriyasya Indriyasya Arthe Ragadvesho Vyavasthitam Tayona Vashamagache Tauhyasya Paripantinam. You must know how to supplement your impulses. Understand Ragadvesh, hatred, aversion, are two forces that are within us and not in the objects of the external world. What you should do is not to allow hatred and aversion to act through the senses. To a person of knowledge, the real hurdles are Ragadvesh. He should not come under their sway, but must go beyond them. This hatred and aversion, they are the enemies one has to encounter in one's spiritual path. Many people really want to evolve, but the pull of the senses and passions is so much that they fall below the standard they have set for themselves. After giving way to the passions or emotions, they begin to regret their actions. They feel regret on second thought or introspection. When you feel such a regret, you can derive some benefit and learn a lesson from it. Utpanna paschattapasya buddhir bhavati adashi tadashi yadi chet purvam kasyana syanmahodaya. When that introspection comes, when you feel really, sincerely, oh God, what did I do that? Why did I do? Really, I have done a blunder. I ought not to have done it. This kind of feeling, actually having something like witness stand, because you are viewing your own actions as a witness. That's why you are able to stand apart your action and see that it was right or wrong. Try to have this witnessing attitude throughout without at the same time associating yourself with it. That part of regret, when you stand as a witness, must be prolonged, and you must practice to be a witness of your actions even when you are actually acting. But that aspect of regret, when you feel sorry for your actions and regret and curse yourself, must be discontinued. On the other hand, you must cultivate equanimity there too. You must tell yourself, all right, I have acted in a foolish manner. This must be a lesson to me. But it is no use my feeling ashamed or sorry for it. I must transcend these feelings. So in order to do that, you must have courage, boldness and strong will to overcome all these hurdles. Kshayan swadharmo vigunaha paradharma sanushtitat swadharme nidram shreya paradharmo bhayavaha. You may be doing something which is without guna, without merits according to you. But recognize that whatever you do, your actions will never be perfect. Everything, every action has merit as well as defect. You are eating food. It has a merit as far as you are concerned because it nourishes you and you need it to maintain and sustain your body. But at the same time, there may be a person somewhere who is dying of starvation at that very moment. Even eating the food contains this sin, that while there is a man dying of hunger, who might still be saved if you give him your food, you are eating it yourself. So even eating food contains guna as well as dosha, merit and demerits. Any action has a bad and a good element in it. So you can't do any action which is wholly good. That being so, you must go beyond both of them. Do whatever work falls to your lot without the least bit of selfishness and without attachment to the fruit of the action. That work will be perfect. Nay, has to be perfect. Since you are having the perfection, it will express itself spontaneously in your actions. You will be doing maximum good to the world. There will be badness in the world always. It is impossible if you are thinking of perfecting yourself only after the world has become absolutely perfect. The world or the society is nothing but individual eyes put together. Unless the individual eyes are made perfect, the society cannot become perfect. To make the individual eyes perfect, you must start by making yourself perfect first. Then and then only can you make the other eyes and the society perfect. This is the reason why all the attempts by man to uplift the society or the nation by devising economic, social, political and other plans fail. You have to uplift a society or a nation, not en masse, but by perfecting individuals, after perfecting first in a soul. That means establishing character is most important, that everything comes out well. Character must be the foundation for uplifting the society. Improve right where you are and right now. We have relations with the outer world. When you come in contact with the objects of the external world, if you try to get joy from them, they must respond as we want them to respond. Otherwise we feel disappointed. They must have the capacity to respond. Even if they have this capacity, the circumstances must be suitable for them to respond, which is often not the case. Thus there is many a strip between the cup and the lip. And man faces disappointments and heartaches at every turn. Do not be conditioned by the world. Let it not affect you. Outlive it, even while living right in the midst of it. Do not be attached to anything in the world. Even when you are unattached, the things that are to come to you will come to you. And even if you are attached, anything that is to go away from you will certainly go away at the appointed time. So, that's the truth. Things happen as they should. It will not stay with you a second longer in spite of your attachment. So, live in the world unattached and do the work that is yours as a karma yogi. Don't think you gain anything by leaving your work and running away from it, even if the work has no guna according to you. Even if you die in the process of acting as a karma yogi, In those very circumstances where you are placed, it is better for you than leaving those circumstances and going away to another. Don't think your job or family stands in your way. Don't think, oh, my job is useless. And Vedanta and my job cannot go together. So I will retire and then practice Vedanta. When you do retire and go to the village, you will get caught up in the village politics and in petty feelings, and you will then feel my job and the hustle bustle of Bombay were much better environments to practice Vedanta. A cow which is gazing on one bank of a river or stream will look at the other bank and think that the grass on the other bank is much greener, fresher, and richer. When it goes to the other bank and looks back at the first bank, it finds that the grass there looks much greener than the grass on the side where it is standing. It is just so with the man also. He thinks he will be happy in another set of circumstances than where he is. As examples of people who have attained liberation by doing karma yoga as a first step, we have already gone through the stories of Dharmavyada and Anusuya. Dharmavyada, the story comes in the Mahabharata. He was a butcher. Not that he liked his profession and took it up, but because the profession descended from his grandfather to father, from whom it came down to him, so he took it up. Though he was not educated, he had Vedantic understanding and an ardent thirst to attain liberation. So he converted his very job of a butcher into karma yoga and gradually attained liberation. Anusuya, in the kitchen, doing her household work as a karma yogi, she attained liberation. The karma yoga brought about chitta parishuddhi, which made her an adhikari for jnana. She did not leave her husband and children and run away to the jungles in order to have liberation. She just concentrated, focused on performing her duties to her family, devotedly in a dedicated way. And she got the realization. So although your work is without guna in the social vision, it will be better for you to do it as a karma yogi than to leave it and take up some other job even if that seems to have more guna, according to you. Hearing all this, Arjuna asks, Adakena prayuktoyam papam charati purusha anichchanapi varshneya baladiva niyojita. O Krishna, Vedanta is really so wonderful that people must know it. Even then, why do they engage in misdeeds and work in such a way that will bring about bondage? Compelled by what force, impelled by whom do individuals in the world commit sin? Sin is anything that will bring you misery, pain, bondage. Even when a person does not want to do anything that will bring about unhappiness and bondage to him, still on many occasions he acts in a way which is just the opposite of what he will like to do. What is the reason of it? What is the reason for it? Arjuna's question is a very intelligent one. We are all eagerly with attention hear teachings of Vedanta. And most of us are eager to improve ourselves. We have no desire to do sin. But in spite of our wish and intention to do only that which is good for us, which will make us evolve, we may be falling far short of the ideal which we have set for ourselves. We do wrong things as though somebody or something is enjoying, compelling us, to do these things forcefully. What is that force? We read the Bhagavad Gita. Still, we are not able to avoid anger, control our passions and the sense organs. We are not rid of attachment, jealousy, greed and envy. We know very definitely these are bad, yet we are not able to avoid them. Why? It's a very important question. So Lord Krishna answers, Kamayesha Krodhayesha Rajoguna Samudvaha Mahashama Mahapapma Vithyenya Vairinam. The force that impels you to do wrong is Kama, desire. It is Krodha, anger. This Kama and Krodha, desire and anger, they are not different, not two, but one and the same. That is, desire, when it is thwarted, when it finds an obstruction to its fulfillment, becomes anger. An example is given. You give a piece of bone to a dog. It gnaws at it avariciously. Try to snatch it off, the dog becomes vicious. It bares its teeth to bite you. This is krodha, anger, which is expression of kama, desire, when it is obstructed. So, desire itself changes into anger. Anger is not born independently. Desire, and hence also anger, is born out of rajogun. Rajogun is the understanding. I am the body, mind and intellect. The world is real. To get joy, I have to work in the world, moving among the objects of that world. In that understanding, we go on working, thinking that we will get so much of joy out of our actions. Rajoguna is a force that makes us extrovert and induces us to do much of physical actions. Our desire is born out of extrovert tendency. The desire is such a voracious eater that the more and more you feed it, fulfill your desires, it will ask for more and more. Desire is such that it will never be satisfied, however much you give away to it. However much you may try to satisfy desire, it still remains to be satisfied. Trying to satisfy yourself by accomplishing your desires is not the correct process, for you will never succeed in it. If one desire is satisfied, in its place 1,000 other desires sprout up. He who kills his desires alone is a king among men. He is even greater than a king. To illustrate this teaching, an episode is given. You know, there was a king in India, his name was Akbar. He was ruling Agra. And there was a Muslim fakir in a nearby forest. Some of the Muslim fakirs or Sufi mystics were great gyanis. One day, the fakir was in the mosque offering his prayers. Next to this fakir sat Akbar, the king, who was praying to God in his own way. He prayed this way, O Allah, I have so many kingdoms, but I have not yet annexed Bengal. Give me soldiers, give me courage, give me strength, power and valor to conquer that state. After conquering that state, I want to conquer another state. He was going on murmuring this, and the Sufi heard it. The next day, Akbar, who had heard about the Sufi, went to him to talk to him. He talked to the Sufi for a good while. Then he said, well, I have learned so much from talking with you, and I am immensely impressed by your wisdom. I beg you to accept these offerings of mine and come to my palace. I will give you every possible comfort that you can think of. Akbar is offering But the Sufi refused either to take the riches offered by Akbar or to go to the palace to live there. Akbar was astonished. He pleaded with him, but the Sufi was adamant in his refusal. Then Akbar asked him why he was refusing to comply with his wishes. The Sufi, a saint, man of knowledge, he answered, "Well, I don't want anything from a beggar." He is addressing the king as a beggar. Akbar was shocked because he thought he was the emperor and this fakir is calling him beggar. He became very angry and shouted at him, "What? You call me the beggar, the great emperor of Hindustan?" The Sufi calmly said, "Yes, yes, you are a beggar, because last night I heard you in the mosque begging this and that of Allah. On the other hand, I am perfectly satisfied and contented. How can I, who need nothing to make me happy, take anything from a beggar who has not enough to make himself happy?" These words of wisdom opened the eyes of Akbar, who realized what an abject slave of desire he was. Like Akbar, we are also making our religion an institution of private begging from God. We pray to God not to give wisdom, not to get liberation. We are praying to God to fulfill our desires. "I want this, I want that. Please do this, please do that." Without knowing that the greatest worship we can do to God is to live a perfect life, ethically and morally. The enemy that stands between you and perfection is desire, which expresses through the body, mind and intellect. With this desire present in us, whatever we do will not be perfectly done. Religion requires control of this desire. As long as these desires control us, we have no religion. What we have will at best be only a pretense of religion. Therefore, control your desires. Control. Desires are the cause of all the happenings. You know the famous episode in Ramayana. Janaki was sitting Sri Ramchandra's consort in a hermitage. Suddenly she saw a golden deer moving in front of the hermitage. It was so enchanting. And Janaki was very joyful to see that deer. Immediately called Ram, "Oh Ram, what a wonderful golden deer I have seen. I have not seen this deer anywhere. This exceptional one. Will you please fetch me this deer? I want to have it." Sri Ramchandra tells, "Why do you aspire for it? Why do you aspire for it? It may be illusion or some demons coming in the disguise of desire, coming in the disguise of this deer." Well, Sita was not satisfied. She insisted, "Well, you must be. Whoever it may be, nobody can confront you. Definitely can bring this deer." So Rama had to go. Finally, you know the story. How that because of the deer, whole episode started opening up. Ravan came, abducted Sita, went to Lanka. Rama came back to Hermitage, not seen Sita, became very upset and sad, began to search the whole story. goes on. So that is it. The one cause of desire, leading to all sorts of things. Indriyanam hi charatam yanmano dividiyate tadasya harati prajnam vayurnam vampasi. The mind which goes after the wanting senses carries away the person's discrimination as the wind carries away a boat on the water. So, O man of strength, O Arjun, that one alone will attain this state of steady wisdom, in whom the senses are controlled and who can resist the mad onrush of the senses towards the sense objects. The control should not be because one is unable to enjoy the sense objects. For example, a diabetic patient has some control, he will avoid sweet things, but that sort of control is useless. One should control the senses when they are running away to external objects. In order to control our desire, we should know where it is seated and how it acts and pulls us down. Then Sri Krishna explains this in the verse Dhumena Vriyate Vanyata Darsho Malena Cha Ethol Pena Vato Garpastata Teniyana Mahavatam. So, conquering desire is a bit difficult. The whole of the third chapter in the Bhagavad Gita from here is devoted to giving the method of conquering desire. Let us continue this next Tuesday. Om Sahana Vavatu Sahana Vunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tejasvinavadidamastu Mavidvishavahai. Om Shanti 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 Hari Om Tat Sat. May the Lord protect us. May He nourish us. May our knowledge be fruitful and enlightened. May we not hate each other. Peace, peace, peace be unto all.